Muy emocionada.
Nosotros también. sprints.
That's amazing. I want to, you know,
This is the story of a unique city. A place where kind, devoted, and dynamic people live. With all the drive of a modern and influential city. Where tomorrow's leaders are forged day by day. And even though every city has its charm, Mérida shines on its own. Capital of Yucatan. A state where more than 2 million people live, talented and passionate. Mérida is a source of inspiration, investment, and creation. Its attractions are breathtaking for visitors from all over the world. In this city, history and culture coexist with the impetus of young university students who demand the maximum and boost the environment to levels of excellence. According to the United Nations, Mérida offers the best quality of life and the safest environment in Mexico. It is second place after Quebec, Canada, as the safest city on the American continent. Considered a pole of innovation, Mérida has one of the largest networks of entrepreneurs in the country. Anáhuac Mayab University is a magnet for active young people, ready to firmly start their life project. Its international university environment, their academic quality, and the affordable cost of living in Mérida attracts students from all over Mexico and the world. With top-notch companies and major developments, Mérida offers job opportunities and a thriving economic environment. Anáhuac Mayab alumni reinvent Mexico as a country of entrepreneurs, leaders, who create and innovate to transform social and economic reality. Leaders who emerge from a study house with more than 35 years of experience in Mérida. Develop your professional relationships and make new friends at Anáhuac Mayab, the University of Mérida. Leader of the Mexican Southeast in academic excellence, international exchanges, integral training centered on the person and graduates with global impact. Dream big. Choose the university that has it all and conquer the world from Mérida. Anáhuac Mayab University.
My name is Kirsten and I'm studying communication in the Anáhuac Mayab University in Mérida. For me, having had this semester in the University of Anáhuac Mayab have given me a lot of good experiences. Among others, it's very different for me, the personal relationship that you can get with the teachers here in Mérida, in the Anáhuac Mayab. Because where I come from, I'm used to having lectures with several hundred students, and back in Denmark, you're basically just a number in a line. And here, every teacher knows your name. You can even get your teacher's cell phone number. You can write them if you have any trouble. It's a very personal relationship. I would recommend every student thinking about going on exchange to come to Mexico, and specifically to Mérida. For me, it has been the greatest half a year of my entire life, and there is so much to learn, see, and experience here in Mérida. Besides the heat, there is just the most spectacular places to visit. There is a completely different culture where people just receive you with open arms. They're very friendly and very familiar. And I feel like this is my second home now.
Buenas tardes a todos los que están conectados en nuestra red institucional, Universidad Anáhuac Mayab y en Anáhuac Mayab Internacional. Soy Marisol Achach, directora de internacionalización de la Universidad Anáhuac Mayab. Bienvenidos a nuestro webcast. Nos encanta que nos acompañen. Compártanos sus comentarios y preguntas en el chat de ambas redes. Tendremos varios momentos durante el webcast para que nuestros invitados respondan a sus preguntas. El webcast será completamente en inglés, pero pueden escribirnos también en español. Saludos a nuestros alumnos, egresados, colegas de universidades socias y a la audiencia que nos acompaña desde diferentes partes del mundo. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Anáhuac Mayab International webcast about how to make better, faster decisions when it really matters. Deciding what's best, whether you're dealing with life's major decisions or its minor details, can be daunting. It can be impossible to know if you're making the right choice. So, how can you find the power to choose what you actually want and the courage to miss out on the rest, especially in these challenging times? We are going to find out in the next hour. Stay tuned and feel free to leave your questions and comments in the chat. I'd like to introduce our guests. I am sure that many of you know them already. Welcome Patrick McGinnis, author of Fear of Missing Out, Practical Decision Making in a World of Overwhelming Choice. Patrick coined the term FOMO, short for fear of missing out, as well as the related term FOBO, or fear of a better option, in a 2004 article in the student newspaper of Harvard Business School. FOMO has been added to the Oxford Dictionary, and FOBO has become an increasingly popular framework to describe choice paralysis. Patrick is the host of the hit podcast FOMO Sapiens, distributed by Harvard Business Review, and the author of the international bestseller, The 10% Entrepreneur, Live Your Startup Dream Without Quitting Your Day Job. He has been featured in the New York Times, Politico, the Financial Times, The Guardian, BBC, CNN, and Forbes, and gave a popular 2019 TED Talk on FOBO and decision making. Originally from Maine, he has visited 103 countries so far, and now lives in New York City. Our second guest will be conducting this interview. Please welcome Courtney Beale, Principal Officer at the U.S. Consulate General in Mérida, Mexico. Courtney was the Public Affairs Officer at the U.S. Embassy in Havana. Prior to Havana, she served as Senior Director of the Global Engagement Office and Special Assistant to the President at the National Security Council. Courtney served in overseas assignments in Mexico, Pakistan, Colombia, and India. In Washington, she was the Office Director for Strategic Planning in the Public Affairs Bureau, a Special Assistant to the Secretary of State, and a member of the line in the Executive Secretariat. Courtney graduated with a Master's in Public Policy from Princeton University and a Bachelor's of Science in Foreign Service from Georgetown University. Courtney, Patrick, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. We really appreciate your time and look forward to the conversation. Let's get started.
Thank you so much, Marisol, and thank you to everybody joining us today. I'm very happy to be with you all and to welcome Patrick back to Mérida. So Patrick is back by popular demand, although virtually this time. The U.S. Consulate in Mérida brought Patrick to Mérida last year as part of an entrepreneurship program to talk about his book, 10% Entrepreneur. And since then, he's published his second book on FOMO and decision making. And this is something that we can all relate to. We've all had the fear of missing out. So Patrick, can you start out by telling us about FOMO and how it influences our decisions?
Yes, and I want to thank you so much, Courtney. It's so good to see you again. And for everybody who's watching, fun fact is Courtney and I actually went to college together. So we've known each other forever. And so it's just so good to be here with you today. So FOMO, or fear of missing out, in Spanish, it's miedo a perder algo, is basically this idea that there's something better that's happening out there while you are doing whatever you're doing. So you're watching television and you turn on your social media, you go on Instagram, or you're watching television and you see something and it looks better than what you're doing at that moment. And you have a feeling, an anxiety, that maybe your life isn't good enough, that you're not taking advantage of the opportunities. And at the same time, it's a fear of being left out of some group experience. So, you know, you always see those pictures of people waiting in line at the Apple store to get the new phone. Or I lived in Mexico City and I would see on tamale, the day there were tamales in my neighborhood, there was a line of like 30 people and I felt left out and I wanted to be a part of that. And so that's what FOMO is. And it's important because it can be funny. We think about all the parties and, you know, that's always portrayed in this very funny way. But the reality is that FOMO causes us to feel stress. It can be a cause of mental health problems. It can diminish our productivity, and it can cause us to spend money on things that we don't even really want. So it has real implications in our daily lives.
Great. Thank you, Patrick. So tell us a little bit about how you came up with this term that has made you so famous.
So I grew up in the state of Maine, as you heard in my intro. And the state of Maine is a very quiet place. I grew up in a very small town of 20,000 people. And this was before the internet. And so I didn't really have a lot of FOMO. And then I went to college and, you know, I was always in the library. And then I went to New York and I was working all the time. And I had no time to think about, you know, what was going on outside of my life. And there was no internet, really. I mean, it was just email at that point. And then in 2001, two things happened that were important. Number one, I was working and investing in a tech firm and doing venture capital. And the tech bubble burst and all my investments went basically bankrupt. Second is I was in New York City the day of the 9/11 attacks when Osama bin Laden obviously attacked New York. And those two experiences were very powerful because I realized for the first time in my life that lots of crazy things can happen and we never know what's going to happen to us. And therefore, every day is so precious and you have to live every day as if it's your last. And so right around that time, I went up to Boston and began studying at Harvard Business School. And Harvard Business School is a very special place. It's what I call a choice-rich environment. So many choices, millions of classes, lots of job opportunities, lots of parties and people and traveling. And I wanted to do all of it. I wanted to take advantage of everything because I realized that life is so short. And what I realized pretty soon was that actually gave me a lot of stress and that I felt like I had to do everything and I had a fear of missing out. And so I started calling it FOMO. And I wrote an article in the school newspaper called basically McGinnis's Two Foes, Social Theory at HBS, all about FOMO in my life. And basically that was the first time it was ever used anywhere. And then later on, it sort of through a bunch of things that happened, it got famous. And thanks to social media, it became something that everybody felt. So now we all can feel FOMO. You don't have to just be in Boston.
For better or for worse.
Right.
You also talk about the term FOBO. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and how it's different than FOMO?
Yes. So FOMO, fear of missing out, is this idea that, you know, you are trying to do everything and you want to experience everything. And so you're running around, you have no focus, right? FOBO is completely the opposite. FOBO stands for fear of a better option. It's a fear that when you're making a decision, that if you choose something, something better might come along. So, you know, for example, you ordering food at the restaurant and you order that dish and what if somebody at your table gets something that looks better? Or say you're going on Netflix and you're trying to pick a movie. You keep searching and searching for the perfect movie, right? And I think we all do that. There are 7,000 potential choices on Netflix. And so FOBO is something that comes from living in an age where we have so much choice. You go on the internet, you can buy anything you want, you can download anything you want. And so as a result, it makes it difficult for us to just choose one thing because we don't want to make the wrong choice. And so unlike FOMO, where you're trying to do everything, FOBO, you don't do anything, you're paralyzed. And that's what that is.
Okay, so we all know that making decisions can be difficult. And when you're a university student, you have a lot of decisions to make about what you're going to study, what kind of work you're going to do, what classes you're going to take. So can you give us some practical tips on how to overcome FOMO and FOBO?
Absolutely. So I'm going to start with something that is actually something I learned at Georgetown when we were in college. And that is the fact that I believe that we only really make three types of decisions in life. And those decisions are high stakes decisions, low stakes decisions, and no stakes decisions. No stakes decisions are things where it doesn't even matter what you choose. Everything is fine. And so, for example, it could be what you're going to have for lunch. Am I going to have tacos or am I going to have tortilla, you know, some sort of tostados, whatever. doesn't matter. Either one is absolutely fine, but we can spend a lot of time trying to decide. And that's a huge waste of time. And so what I tell people is when it comes to the little things in life, the things that don't really matter, things that you won't even remember in a day or two, just simply outsource it. So what I do is I look down at my watch. The left side is, say, you know, tacos. The right side is a sandwich. I see where the second is, and then the decision is made for me. You can also do it with your phone, even or odd on your phone. You could flip a coin. But basically the idea here, and this is something I learned when I was in college, is that I used to spend a lot of time on decisions that don't really matter. And by outsourcing that decision, you're able to quickly move through it, move on with your day, and then spend your time on things that are much more important. Now, when it comes to the big things in life, things that are actually important, for example, say you're deciding on a summer internship, okay? And you've got three offers and you can't decide between them. And you're also thinking, oh my goodness, what happens if something, you know, next week I get another opportunity. And so you're stuck. And this happens all the time. And what happens for a lot of people is they just end up feeling a lot of stress, right? And that's really FOBO, because you're fearing that if you choose one thing, well, what if this other thing was actually better, right? And we don't know the future. We can't have a perfect view of the future. And so here, what we have to do with FOBO is two things. So when we feel FOBO, it's because we're trying to have the perfect outcome. And first of all, you need to accept the fact there is no perfect outcome. Second, you need to think deeply about your criteria. What's important to you? Do you care about money? Do you care about experience? Do you care about the type of work? Do you care about how hard you're going to work? So you really want to think about those things and write them down. I always encourage people, write it down. And it's important to write things down because it's much harder to have a bad logic structure if you're doing it on the paper versus on your head. You're forced to be structured about the way you're thinking. Next, you're going to do research and figure out for each of the options you have, okay, does it meet my criteria or not? You're going to talk to people, you're going to do some thinking and some reading, and you're going to try to get as much information as you can. And as you do that, you're going to realize, okay, actually this option is not very good and this one's better. You're going to get a better sense of where you are. But at the very end, the critical thing is, in order to pick just one thing, you have to be comfortable getting rid of the other things. In order to choose one thing, you cannot have everything. And that's the critical part of making decisions, right? And so what I recommend you do is, say you have three options at the end and you can't decide between the three. Actually, that's not a bad problem to have, because it means that you have three good options. I mean, you should feel good about that. Then what you do is you pick one of those options, the one that you think might be the most interesting, but you aren't certain. You compare that with one of the other options. And of those two, you force yourself to pick the one that you like better, and you permanently eliminate the one that is the loser. And what you're doing there is tricking your brain to say, I got what I wanted, and I'm never going to look at that one again. Because what happens is, if you don't eliminate an option and you just keep going back to the same group, that's where you have problems. So you repeat that till you get to your final option and you move forward. So it's really a process at the end of the day. There's nothing wrong with wanting the best. The problem is that when we try to get the best, but we don't let go of anything, that's where we get stuck.
Great. Thanks, Patrick. So in addition to being an entrepreneur and a writer, you also have a podcast where you interview really cool and interesting people. And I'm hoping you can tell us a little bit more about that and what you've learned from them. Have they offered any tips that might be able to help students watching us with decision making?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I also tell you, so I've been doing this podcast for a while. And if you speak English or you want to practice your English, it's called FOMO Sapiens, and it's distributed by Harvard Business Review. And it does pretty well in Mexico. So maybe some of you are listening already. And I love podcasts. And in fact, there's another podcast that I recommend to everybody. If you don't know it, it's called Cracks, and it's by Oso Trava, who is a really smart friend of mine. It's in Spanish. So if you want some Spanish language content about entrepreneurship, Oso is amazing and a good friend. And so you should check that out. So on the show, on FOMO Sapiens, what we do is we talk to entrepreneurial thinkers about how they make important decisions. And so I had on the show, for example, somebody who was running for president of the United States, Andrew Yang. I have had the founder of Tom's Shoes, that many people know this shoe company. Had all kinds of people from Reddit, people. I had a woman called Eglantina Singh, who is a famous DJ from MTV and is also a model in Latin America. So she's from Venezuela. So I've had all these different people. And some of the good advice, I would say, number one is, it's a lot of the people who are successful are very good at knowing which decisions are worth their time and which decisions are not worth their time. So they're really careful. For example, Steve Jobs, he wasn't on my podcast, but I wish he had been, but he knew every day that he wore the same thing because he just thought, this is not important to me and I just want to not deal with that every day. So a lot of successful people are good at doing that. The other thing that people do really well is delegation. Just like I delegate to the watch to make decisions, people delegate to the people around them, and trying to do everything yourself is very hard and very stressful. And then the final thing I'd say is that people are, a lot of the people that are, they've been on the show that are successful, have certain habits and practices that help them just to be healthier. So for example, the founder of Tom's, Blake Mycoskie, came on the show, and he has started a new company that's all about establishing healthy habits. And two of the big healthy habits that we can have in our life are sleeping well and drinking enough water every day. These are very simple things, but if you don't drink enough water, you don't feel good and your body chemistry is off. And the final thing that he talked about, which I thought was really valuable, is gratitude. Every day he spends time focusing on why he is grateful. And I think that's something that, as I remember, I never thought about these things. And frankly, I thought it was like a little, I don't know, it was a little silly to do these things. Maybe it was like a hippie kind of thing. But frankly, science shows us that if you spend every day a little bit of time thinking about what you're happy about and what makes you grateful, you actually are happier and have a more productive life. So it's really worthwhile thinking about how you can do these things.
Well, those are great tips, especially in the era we're living in now of the coronavirus. And it's really changed how we see other people doing things. You know, I don't have as much FOMO because nobody's out and about having really very much fun. We're all at home taking care of ourselves. But it also means that we're making decisions in a lot of uncertainty. We have to make decisions about what's safe, about how to get done what we need to do, you know, maybe about, for students, whether they're going to be going back to classes in person or online, or how this might influence their career options. So can you talk about how you've applied these principles to your own life during coronavirus, and how we can be thinking about making the best decisions for us in a lot of uncertainty?
Yeah, it's so important. And this has been such a difficult time, but I would say also, living in New York City, so we have been the global center of coronavirus, and I've been here the entire time except for 1 week when I left 2 weeks ago finally. But I've been here, and so I've had a lot. I think it's been an extraordinary opportunity to learn, and in fact, all of us can learn right now, and this will serve us so much better for the future. For the next time something bad happens, we'll have built up the resilience to deal with that better. Now, I'll tell you a couple things. Number one is, when the coronavirus came, I remember saying, I have no more FOMO anymore. And in fact, I stayed home and I learned how to cook, you know, did all these things that I'd never done. But it is interesting. It felt like we had no FOMO, but in reality, I would argue actually FOMO is alive and well. First of all, the amount of people buying toilet paper and things like that, the people who don't want to socially distance, all of that is FOMO. And so it's just interesting to see how that works. Also, all the amount of webinars that we've all participated in, and Zoom social events and all this sort of stuff, my social life online is sometimes it overwhelms me more than the one I used to live in real life. So I do think that it has survived, but I would say, one thing that's really valuable to do that I would encourage everybody to do is this. I remember at the beginning of the pandemic, reading on Twitter this piece of advice that said, just remember that Shakespeare wrote King Lear during the plague. And so you can do some great things. And I thought, I'm going to do so many great things during the coronavirus quarantine. I'm going to get in amazing shape. I'm going to like come up with a brilliant idea. I'm going to reach out and see all the people I haven't seen in a long time. And the reality is I've done some of those things, but the other thing is the one thing that I brought with me into quarantine, which is very bad for FOMO, is my phone. And if you look at screen time, and I encourage you to do this, look at your screen time. I bet you're spending more time on your phone than you've ever done before. So the first piece of advice I have to you is remember the things that you wanted to achieve. Think about how you're spending your time and recalibrate. You still have time. You're going to be in quarantine a little longer. So think about what you wanted to achieve. And if you have not achieved it yet, think about how you're spending your time and change that. Number two, I would say that the thing about this whole thing that's very valuable is to think carefully about what you miss and then think about what you don't miss and decide that you're going to live your life differently going forward, right? That's an important thing to do. Like, I don't miss certain things that I used to think were important. I do miss going to a restaurant and eating food. I'm going to appreciate that more than I did before. And finally, Courtney, when it comes to uncertainty, so if you'll remember the definition of FOMO is it's a perception that there's something better out there that you're not doing right now. And the thing is, it's perception. You don't know. And so when you feel those feelings, ask yourself, is this really what it seems to be? Or if I think deeply about this, does it not really matter, right? And so think about the unknowns out there. You can never know all the answers, but you can certainly do a lot of research to take out the unknown. And finally, when it comes to the uncertainty of, like, for example, if you're thinking about your future and a job, I know that can be very unsettling. That's, that comes back to something important, which is, you know, not about FOMO, by the way, but I talk a lot about entrepreneurship. And I would say we're in a time when everything is changing and crisis also creates opportunity. So right now, if you're wondering what the future is going to bring for you, I would offer you two pieces of advice. Number one, reevaluate everything you thought you knew about the world and try to think and listen to smart people and look at other places in the world about what the world might look like and how you can change your approach. You may have been doing something like that now doesn't make sense. Be open to change. Number two is take care of yourself, because you can't predict the future, but you can be mentally strong so that when you get there, you're in a good position to be flexible and do the things you knew you need to do to succeed.
Thanks, Patrick. That's great advice. I believe we're going to take some questions from our viewers now. So I'll hand it back over to Marisol.
Thank you, Courtney. Thank you very much, Patrick. Lily Campo Moreno wants to know, Patrick, what was your inspiration to make FOMO?
So, you know, back in my school days, as I mentioned, I just felt I felt this incredible anxiety, and I thought it was kind of funny. So my article in the newspaper was in the humor section, believe it or not. But I just felt it was important because it was this moment in time that was so different than the rest of my life before. I wanted to remember it. I wanted to write it down. And here's a great thing for all of you students that I would encourage you to do. When you have an idea, put it into the world, write about it, do a video about it. And I know many of you do, make a podcast, because you never know where your ideas will take you. And so I never thought that this little article I wrote back in school would become a big part of my life, but I feel so thankful that it did. And so if you have an idea or take on something, go out there and tell the world about it, because you never know what it will achieve.
Okay, Guille Santana wants to know, how has quarantine shaped FOMO?
So as I mentioned in the last comments, I think there was a period. I remember I read on Twitter, FOMO is dead. FOMO got killed by the coronavirus. And I was like, yeah, you're right. And then I thought, oh, this is kind of not great for me because I have a book coming out on this in like 3 weeks, but I'm happy for the world. Then, you know, what happened was, at least, you know, I think this is true, and many of you, I'm sure, would agree, is that FOMO became something much deeper than that party you were missing. It became about seeing your family, like seeing abuelita. It was about going to school and seeing your friends. It was about the life you should have been leading. And so what I think is going to happen, if I may make a prediction, is that when we're able to come outside and live our lives again, we're going to go crazy and you're going to see more FOMO than you ever saw. And that's okay, because when you have FOMO, it means you have something to miss out on. So enjoy the FOMO for a little while and then rein it back in.
Thank you, Patrick. The next question is for Courtney. Courtney, Karina wants to know, can you share with us an example you would use FOMO as the consul in Mérida?
Sure, that's a good question. In our consulate here in Mérida, we cover the three states in the Yucatan Peninsula, Yucatan, Quintana Roo, and Campeche, but we all live here in Mérida. So the FOMO that I face is that I constantly want to be out traveling, seeing the beautiful peninsula, experiencing everything from Holbox to, you know, the Ciudad del Carmen. There's so much to do around here and so many areas where the connection between the United States and Mexico is really important. And so I have to evaluate, when should I travel? When do I need to stay in Mérida? When I do travel, what should I best do with my time in order to kind of make the most of trying to foster people-to-people ties and strengthening the relationship between the United States and Mexico? And so I usually look at what are the events that if I don't go to, I'll really have FOMO. Well, who are the people I really want to see? Who are the ties that I really want to help build? And then try to base my travel around it and enjoy living in Mérida when I'm not traveling, because this is just such a wonderful place to get to live and work. I think all my family and friends have FOMO, seeing all the fun stuff before quarantine, all the fun stuff that we got to do, you know, cenotes and ruins. And I have lots of friends and family say they have FOMO seeing our pictures.
Thank you, Courtney. Patrick, this one is for you. Pablo Martinez wants to know, why does it seem that young people are who most suffer from FOMO?
Yeah, great question, Pablo. So here's the thing. FOMO, as I mentioned before, the definition is it's a perception there's something better out there for you. And the thing is, as you live more life, you have more experiences to draw from, and therefore you're a better judge of whether or not something is what you think it's going to be. So for example, when I was 23 years old, every nightclub looked like amazing to me, and I wanted to go, and I did. I went to every nightclub. I'll admit it. Now I've been to so many, I kind of know. I'm like, okay, this is what that's going to be. Do I want to do that or no? I go or I don't. That's part of it. Number two is younger people have more energy just to do things, right? They just have, and number three, they have oftentimes more free time. If you're, you know, you got three kids and you're working all the time, you're just too tired to have FOMO. But what happens is later in your life, when your kids leave and you have more free time and you realize I'm not going to live forever, you get tons of FOMO. So ask your grandparents about the FOMO. I can tell you they have it.
Thank you, Patrick. Maria Jose Valencia wants to know, what was the biggest challenge you faced while writing your books?
That's a great question. Thank you. Okay, so the first book I wrote, I'd never done that before, and it just was so hard to know if it was any good. You just think everything you write is terrible and that people are going to make fun of you and put it on social media that you're terrible. And then I realized I wrote the first book and it did great, and so I felt confident about my writing. Now, I put on 15 pounds when I wrote that book, okay? And I was just like in terrible shape because you sit so much. So my decision with my second book was to come to Mexico. I went to Mexico City. I got an apartment in Condesa, and I decided to train for a half marathon. So every day I would write all day, and then I would run. And so that actually was a really good way to deal with that. And I think the hard thing about the second book was that when you write your first book, you kind of put all your ideas you ever had into that book. And then when you have, because you're like, this may be my only chance to write a book. And then with the second one, you're like, okay, now I have to do this again and I need new ideas. And so that's also why I wanted to go to Mexico, because I wanted to go someplace where I would feel creative. And as we know, Mexico and Mexicans and Mexico City is a place where creativity is everywhere, right? Mexicans are creative people, right? And so being in that environment was really helpful to me in terms of writing the book.
Great, Patrick. I have some other questions from Alexa Ramos. Hi, Patrick. How can we avoid FOMO?
Yes. So the critical thing about avoiding FOMO, besides thinking critically about whether this thing is as good as it looks, is I'm going to give you a couple of very simple things you can do today that'll change your life, I promise. Number one, move the Instagram, the TikTok, the Facebook, either take them off your phone 100% or put them in a folder in the back so that they're not the first thing you see on your phone, okay? Because that is... if you look at your stats on your phone, and all of our phones have this, you can see how many times you check Instagram a day. I'll admit it, I'm on Instagram all the time. I use it for work, but you know, again, that's a FOMO generator for me. I know that. And so I actually took Twitter off my phone, for example. Number two, do not ever bring your phone in your bedroom. Put your phone somewhere else. Because the temptation is to wake up in the middle of the night, because we all use our phone for an alarm clock, right? And so then we have it with us. Don't use it as an alarm clock. Get a proper alarm clock. Keep your phone elsewhere. 88% of people look at their phone right first thing when they get up in the morning, and you're bombarded by all these thoughts and it drives you crazy and it's very negative for FOMO. And the third thing I'd recommend you do, and maybe some of you guys do this, but if you don't, I'd recommend it, is start meditating. So meditation is a very powerful tool to beat FOMO, because when you feel FOMO, what's really happening is you're having a war with yourself inside your head, right? And so from a neurological, biological perspective, it's about the fact that you're disconnected from reality, and that's what creates the stress. Now, when you are doing meditation or mindfulness, and you know, there's lots of different ways to do that, and I'd encourage you to research that. What you're actually doing is just getting away from that. And for a period of time, just being present in the reality of your world, what is real to you, what is actually going on, not what's going on up here. And so that's a very powerful tool to break the cycle of FOMO. And that's something that I talk to a lot of psychologists and biologists about this. And everybody says that it's an important tool to fight FOMO. And so meditation doesn't have to be going in a temple and spending 9 hours. I do 10 minutes a day, every day, and it's very powerful and it really works for me. So I'd encourage you to do that too.
Thank you, Patrick. Thanks to the audience for your questions. We will have some more time at the end of the transmission to answer more. Back to you, Courtney.
Thanks, Marisol. So Patrick, speaking of new ideas, having coined FOMO and talked about FOBO, what do you think is the next big fear of trend?
So I started using a term. I won't claim that I invented this term, because I think a few other people might have used it, but not many people. But I started using a term called FOGO, fear of going out, in early March. So I would, because I was still going around a little bit more than my friends were right before quarantine. Of course, when quarantine started, I went right home, but I was one of the last people walking around New York City, and I would take pictures, and my Instagram is Patrick J. McGinnis. You can find stuff on my Instagram if you want to see. And I noticed everyone was empty. Places that would usually be full of people had nobody. I went to Grand Central Station, which, as many of you know, is like the most crowded place in New York, and there were 4 people there. So I started calling that FOGO. And so I think it's an important term, because now what's happening, we're at a point where we're now able to start doing more things outside of our houses. And I'm sure you'll be at that point soon. And a lot of people, even though we're told, like, listen, wear a mask, go outside, it's okay, you know, just be socially distanced. We kind of know now what you can do that's safe. A lot of people feel very afraid because this is something we can't see. It's an abstract threat. And so it's very, you know, where a lot of people have mental health challenges around getting back into their normal lives. So that fear of going out, it's something we're all going to deal with. And just like FOMO, you have to start thinking critically about what's real and what is fear, what's going on in my head, and then try to use facts and information to make smart decisions.
Thanks, Patrick. Since we are with students today, can you talk about how you think everything that's happening and how life has moved virtual may influence the future of work and the types of careers or work environments that students these days will be coming into in the work world?
That's an excellent question. And so I've been thinking a lot about this. I'll tell you from my perspective, just so you understand that I fully get this. In early March, everything I was doing in my life work-wise got canceled. I lost everything. And it was terrible, I'll admit it. But then I basically moved everything I did online, and now it's all come back and more. And so I've been forced personally to, I would have never thought about giving talks in Mexico on my Wednesday afternoon, but here I am and I love it. So, you know, I think a lot of good has come out of this. I mean, I don't want to be on Zoom all day, but I like doing these things. So we're very lucky. Now, in terms of the future of work, many of you know, or some of you may know, that I also do in venture capital in Latin America. So I'm looking at the trends and looking at the companies. And Mexico, of course, is like, you know, there's so much opportunity. We're always looking at Mexico. And what we're seeing, and I'd encourage some of you to think about this, is that online education is becoming important, and learning skills that can be translated into careers that are online is very attractive. So things like programming, things like online marketing, I mean, there's all these areas where you can acquire skills, where you could now have a job. There's so many companies that are hiring remotely. So it used to be that companies would say, okay, you have to live in New York City in order to work here. Now, because of these changes, companies are gonna be willing to hire all over the world. And so you could, if you acquire skills that are real good practical skills that businesses value, you could have a career from Mexico where you're working all over the world. So I would think deeply about what you think the future looks like. I mean, I can tell you, I think it's going to be things around programming. It's going to be things around creating digital content. It's going to be about figuring out how to give people meaningful experiences online. And then think about how you can acquire those skills at the university, or maybe you go on, one of these platforms to get supplementary skills like a Crejana. And another thing I think is, like, in Mexico in particular, fintech, there's so much opportunity in fintech, and we're going to see that the financial services is going to change a lot because the banking sector, you know, is going to change a lot because of all of these things. So I think actually Latin America, because Latin America is less digital than other parts of the world, it's going to have to catch up quickly. And this is a time of really big opportunity for Mexico and other parts of Latin America.
Thank you, Patrick. You were talking about how education is changing. And one of the questions that I hear most often from students in Merida is about studying overseas or studying in the United States. And one of the responsibilities that we have here in Merida is to help promote opportunities to study in the United States, because we know that that helps foster a strong people-to-people and bilateral relationship. And what I hear from students is that they know they want to study overseas, but there are so many choices, what country to go to, what university to go to. The United States alone has over 3,000 universities. So what advice would you offer a student who's putting aside the complications of studying abroad right now during the pandemic, but who's thinking about maybe in 2 years, towards the end of their time in university, how to decide about studying abroad?
Oh, that's a great question. And where did you study abroad, Courtney, in college?
I studied abroad in Spain, and I worked abroad in Slovenia.
That's impressive. I went to Argentina, And I'm sure you had the same experience that studying abroad changed my life. It's probably the most consequential thing I ever did. And so I think it's a great idea. And we'd be so happy to have you in the United States, you know, all of you who are listening when things get back to normal, because we are honored to have people visit our country and study in our universities. And it makes it better for everybody. Now, I would say I'm going to be like very I should say go to the best university where you're going to get the best education and you're going to study all the time. I'm going to say something different, which is, and I think you probably agree with me, Courtney, is when I went to Buenos Aires, I went to a very hard university, and actually like I barely studied and I barely passed. It was really kind of terrible. Thank God the grades didn't transfer, but I went to Buenos Aires, which was a place I'd always wanted to spend time, where I made amazing connections and where I really learned Spanish. And so as you think about what your, you know, you need to have your criteria. If your goal is to like get into Harvard Medical School, then trying to go to an amazing biology program might be the best thing for you to do. But if you're trying to learn English and have an international experience and meet people, I would say go to some place that is completely different than what you live right now. Like if you're in Merida, you know, you guys have such good weather and, you know, it's like so beautiful. Go have an experience in a place like where I'm from, Maine, where it's cold and it's all these forests. Like just push yourself in a completely different direction, a place where you're going to feel like a fish out of water. And I can tell you that when we have these moments where we push ourselves in those directions, it's hard. You may get there and be like, what have I done? But you will get the most growth from that. You know what I mean? And so that's what I tell you to say. A lot of people go to like Australia because it's really nice, and it is really nice, but you know, push yourself harder than that.
Thanks, Patrick. I appreciate your honesty. I'm going to turn it back over to Marisol, but I want to ask one final question before I do, which is, what is your favorite question to be asked that we haven't asked you today?
Oh my goodness. That is so hard, Courtney. You're so mean. I will tell you that my favorite question, you know what I always like is like, where am I going to go first when the pandemic ends? That I like that question. And I guess I should answer it. And you have to answer it first though.
Where am I going to go when the pandemic ends?
Like on pleasure travel, where would be the first place you would go? And it can't be Mexico.
Oh, wow. You know what? I really want to go see my family in the United States. I'm from St. Louis, and I would give anything just to go have a big 4th of July backyard picnic and eat all my favorite foods and see all my family. So that's my trip that I would take if I could.
That's awesome. I get that. Yeah, I'm going to go see my family soon. And so that's FOMO for you. In terms of where I would go, I swear to God, I was like thinking, how can I go to Mexico? I want to go to Mexico City. So that might be one of them. I also was thinking Buenos Aires. So I've traveled to all these places. I want to go back. I don't need new countries anymore. I want to go back to the places that are my favorites. And so, tal vez nos vemos en México. We'll see.
Bueno, espero que sí. Y si viene a Ciudad de México, tienes que visitarnos en Mérida también.
Obvio.
Awesome. All right, well, I'll hand it back over to Marisol for more questions from the audience.
Thank you very much, Courtney. Thank you, Patrick. It's amazing. Carla Matos, she wants to know, hi, Patrick. I would like to know, what is the most challenging thing about being in so many countries and how this helped you to make decisions?
That's a great question. The most challenging thing, honestly, is like getting to sleep at night with all the jet lag. But I'd also say from a more substantive thing, I think in the beginning, and I think I've gotten good at this now, but it's just like constantly not knowing what's going on. You know, you don't know you have no familiarity with anything. So everything is unfamiliar. You're not quite sure how to operate. Now, of course, over time, what you come to realize is that the world is kind of the same. I mean, some places are very, very different, right? If you go to rural Ethiopia or you go to a village in Uganda, it's nothing like, you know, New York City, right? But in general, you start to learn how to recognize patterns and communicate with people. And so I think that's really helpful. And in terms of decision-making, I would say, what you learn with travel is you get to know yourself better. And so then you have this self-knowledge to make better decisions for yourself. Oop, you're on mute.
Giselle Zavala wants to know, what advice would you give us to encourage us in this situation and to face the uncertain future?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Okay, so I talked a little bit about the science of gratitude, and this is something that I've done a bunch of reading about, actually. There's a whole sort of area of psychology called positive psychology. And what it studies is, you know, typically psychology shows we look at people who are having psychological problems and we try to figure out how to get them back to normal, whatever normal is, but, you know, back to feeling okay. There's another branch of psychology, positive psychology, where you study people who are very happy and successful and you try to figure out how the rest of us can do the same things as them, right? How do we emulate or copy their behavior in our own lives so that we can be as happy as they are? And one of the things that I've learned in studying this is that it's very important to recognize and be in touch with the good things in your life. You know, you can get up every morning and make a decision. Am I gonna focus on what I don't have, or am I gonna value what I do have? So even during the pandemic, every day I try to think of three things that happened that I'm grateful for. I think of three people who I'm grateful for, and I think of three things about me that I'm grateful for. Every day I've done that. And I have to tell you, it just makes you feel better. And the science shows it. So I would encourage you to do that. Do that. And if you do that, you will find the good things in your life that will get you to the future.
Thank you, Patrick. Citlali Leticia is asking, how can you lose the fear of making difficult decisions?
So decision-making is like any other, it's like a sport. You know, I ran the New York Marathon. And I ran that in 2016. In 2010, I had never run more than 3 miles. And then I started running 4 miles. And then it was 6 miles. And then over time I trained and then I ran a marathon. And Courtney is a triathlete, so she knows all about this too. And the thing is, like anything else, practice, practice, practice. And I encourage you, when you make difficult decisions, write down everything so that later on you can go back and read your thinking and compare it to what actually happened and learn what you did right and what you did wrong. And so that, you know, it's all about practice. And the other thing is, if you get good at making small decisions and you practice making small decisions, then you'll be better at making big decisions. So definitely, you know, you just need to recognize that decision-making is never easy, but if you don't make a decision, you'll never move forward to that next set of decisions. And so you gotta work at it.
Thank you, Patrick. Alebeño is asking, what can we do to not feel overwhelmed with everything that is happening right now?
Yeah, I mean, I feel overwhelmed too. I get it. And somebody told me something kind of interesting, which was in the quarantine, you have 3 good days and then 1 terrible day. And I definitely have felt that way. It's like, I'm feeling pretty good, you know, and then like all of a sudden I just want to like stay in bed all day because it's just awful. One thing that's really helped me, besides the gratitude stuff that I mentioned, which I do think really makes a difference, limit your exposure to the news. Do not look at the news. You will find out anything relevant you need to know. You know, I know you guys, I don't think you felt the earthquake where you were, but obviously there was this earthquake in Mexico, which is upsetting, right? But you don't need to read all about it. You don't need to read about what's happening with coronavirus in New York. Just take the news that's most critical to you and use that time that you save all the time to do something that is good for you, to read a book, to spend time with family, to learn how to cook as I did. I made tortilla soup because I was not watching the news. It's very hard to make, but it was delicious. So that's what I encourage you to do. That'll help you to move forward. Remember, every day, what's weird about quarantine is like every day is so different and every day is exactly the same. So it's a really weird life that we're living in. But I would encourage you to just think about what you can do every day for yourself to make yourself a little better.
Thank you, Patrick. Carlos Ruby wants to know, how can a modern consumerist society that encourages filling the gaps in your life with products, experiences, and services coexist with a holistic movement whose objective is to focus on what matters inside?
I love it. That's such a thoughtful question. Thank you so much for it. I would argue you're so right. We live in a consumerist time. We have all kinds of things, but I think there is a change coming. And I see this in your generation, especially. I mean, I see that the people who are university students or in their 20s, they're not as consumerist as my generation is, okay? They don't buy as much stuff. They care more about the companies that they buy things from. They care about their view on racism, on the environment. And we're so lucky that you do that, because that changes our society. And so what I would say is that these types of experiences and the fact that, you know, you have this conversations going on helps to change the culture. It won't happen overnight, but I do think that societies change. And, you know, I think we will see that people will start to hopefully think more carefully about what's important to them. That being said, as much as I'd love to believe that that's the answer and I've just solved the problem, FOMO has existed since the earliest humans were living in Eastern Africa. It's part of our DNA. And so we will always be, you know, we will always have some of those feelings. But I think that I truly am hopeful that people now are starting to realize that some of the behaviors that we've had, the way we've treated the earth, the consumerism, it's created problems that we now have to grapple with and that we will take those on.
Thank you, Patrick. Luis Adrian is asking, how would you apply FOMO in situations where missing out is not an option? You have to miss out, like COVID.
Yeah, I mean, that's the beauty of thinking deeply about the roots of FOMO. Remember, it's a perception that there's something better out there for you. If it's not available to you, you just have to tell yourself. I'd love to play in the NBA. I'm also not a very tall person. So like, I can't have FOMO about that. I just accept that it's not for me. And I think what's one way to do that is to recognize that the minute you let go of that thing, you have space for something new that may be much more relevant to you. So, you know, just let go.
Thank you, Patrick. Guillermo Tour is asking, does a FOMO scale exist? Is there a level in which I should do something?
Yes, in fact, there is. And you could actually take a FOMO quiz on my website, patrickmcginnis.com, that actually you can measure your level of FOMO. But what I encourage people to do when they're deciding, should I do this or not? Listen, if it's something that's, you know, you can do and it's not painful and you want to learn about it, there's nothing wrong with a little FOMO, okay? Actually, FOMO can be a force for good. If you're feeling FOMO about something like, oh, I'm feeling FOMO about starting a company, you know what? Great. The critical thing to do is when you have FOMO, think about how you can try that thing out and learn about it and figure out, is it really as good as it looks before you jump in full time? So my first book, The 10% Entrepreneur, or Emprendedor 10%, which is out in Mexico, and I would love you to consider checking out because I think it's a good time. There it is in English. All of you guys are bilingual, so you could read it in whatever language you want. But it's all about how to be an entrepreneur part-time, because the point here is a lot of people have entrepreneurship FOMO, and I say, great. Before you decide to quit your job and become an entrepreneur, look into it, explore it, try it, see if you like it. Don't jump in the pool before you know how to swim. And so I think that that's kind of, you know, to your question, I think that FOMO can be wonderful. It can tell us a lot of things. It's like a little, you know, little person sitting on our shoulder whispering in our ear, but then it's important to do the homework and to make sure that it makes sense for you to do it.
Thank you, Patrick. Nicole Phelps wants to know, what advice in terms of FOMO would you have for someone who is moving to Mérida from the United States?
Yeah, you're going to give all of your friends FOMO, first of all. I think the thing that's tough about Merida, and it's the same thing that's tough about Miami, is that like you're in a place where it's beautiful outside all the time, maybe hot, a little hot, but still beautiful, where you just, you don't want to be working. Like, say you have to work. Like, Courtney, I don't know how you do it. If I were you, I would be, I'd be like in Tulum every weekend. You know what I mean? Like, I would never, you know, and here you have to work and you work hard. So the FOMO to, and also it's a new place. So you want to experience everything and travel around the country. And so I think the critical thing that I would advise that person is think very carefully about what you need to do professionally to get your work done, so that it, and be very efficient so you have enough free time to experience all the great things that you're going to be able to have in Merida and in Mexico.
Thank you, Patrick. I have a few more questions. Janica Carreño. Hi, Patrick. I have a question. Do you consider that FOMO affects differently depending on the culture?
That's a wonderful question. Thank you. Yes, the answer is yes. And in fact, I, since I've traveled to all these countries, I ask people, I've done like live experiments on FOMO. And I would say definitely countries that have like a collectivist society, it's very different. So if you live in a highly individualistic society where there's lots of choice and it's consumerist, like my beloved United States, there's a lot of FOMO. If you live in a place that's much more like, say, rural, and there aren't as many opportunities because it's just a simpler life, and you are, you know, you're there's a lot of like your parents sort of are very involved in the decisions you make, it's a totally different type of FOMO. And then there are certain places where I found three places on the world where people just like didn't think there was any FOMO and just didn't get, they said to me like, that's a bad idea, I don't understand that. And that's Jamaica, Turkmenistan, and rural Ethiopia. And I think those places, Jamaica, I think it's just like the people are so laid back that they don't really think about, it was amazing. Like people thought I was crazy to talk about FOMO. And in Turkmenistan and in rural Ethiopia, there's just not any technology. And so people don't have a lot of information about what they could be missing out on. So I think those types of factors definitely drive it. And you, a place like New York City is like the world capital of FOMO.
Thank you, Patrick. Lily Campo Moreno is asking, what has been the biggest FOMO of your life?
Oh my goodness, it's so hard. Biggest FOMO of my life. I would say, oh, I know. Okay. Now you're getting deep inside my head. So I invest in companies. And if I make a good investment, you know, I can make a great return. And if I don't invest, then I get nothing, right? Or I lose. And so I always like had a couple of I had a company that I was going to invest in and I decided not to. And it became a huge hit. And it just was like, oh my goodness, like, why didn't I make that investment? And so I think that's where I feel it is when I miss an opportunity to invest in something. Thankfully I've had ones that I did invest in did well, but when you miss that opportunity and you're like, what was I thinking? That gives me a lot of FOMO.
Thank you, Patrick. Gerardo Montes wants to know, having plenty of different things to work on the internet, how can we focus to get a job done without FOMO?
Yeah, great question. Okay, you're gonna go listen to my podcast because I did two episodes on this. One is about work from home and one is about how to be focused when you're working on your own. And so the episodes will give you a lot of information, but let me give you one thing that I like to do. So I actually have an old fashioned hourglass, like with sand in it, that is half an hour long. And I put it on my desk and I flip it over and I work with no distraction. I disconnect the internet and I work for 30 minutes without doing anything else. And then I take a break. And so doing work sprints, and especially, you know, maybe using a timer or a clock rather than your phone to do them, is a very good way of being focused in your work. And it's been my lifesaver.
Great. The last question from Sara Arenas Palau.
Hi, Patrick. What is more common, having FOBO or FOMO? Could you give an example of each in your life? Thank you.
Great question. And a great one. Is that our last question? Is that right?
Yeah, it's the last question.
Okay. So that's a good one to end on. So thank you, Sara. Okay. Here's the deal. FOMO, I'll give you a great sort of like, it's like all my friends are going to be studying abroad in Spain. And like, I don't know if I can go, or I'm not sure, or I haven't decided, but they're all going to be there, and like, Spain's amazing, and what should I do? That's kind of a FOMO thing. A FOBO thing would be like, well, I could study in Spain, or I could study in the United States, or I could study in Peru, or I could study in some other part of Mexico, or I could study in France, and oh, I don't know what to do. And like, they're all so great. And if I go to the United States and I can't go to France, and maybe I'll meet my husband in France. And like, oh, you know, that's the thing with FOBO. So you're like, with the first one, it's like, you want to do it. And it's like, you're like freaking out because you want to do everything. The second one, it's like, oh, there's so many great choices. How do I decide? Now, the reality is that FOMO is something that all of us can have. Because the reality is, we all have smartphones. We all know we can see what's out there in the world. And so it's very natural for us to feel FOMO. And so you can be in a rural village in Uganda. And I've been to a village in Uganda, and people have cell phones and they're watching on YouTube and they see these lives, and like, they have FOMO because they're like, oh my God, look at this. I want to go to London or whatever it is. FOBO, on the other hand, is something that is about having lots of real opportunities and not being able to choose. And so, for example, if you you're really sick and you're in the hospital, it's very hard to have FOBO at that moment because you're just trying to make it through the day. And so that's a really important thing to think about, is that FOMO is something that is about, like, you know, dreams and living in the world. FOBO is about having lots of options, and it may be that you lose those options. And so it's important to value the options you have and act on them, because you never know what's going to happen in the future. You know, you 3 months ago, you probably had 17 parties to choose from and you couldn't decide. Now there's no parties and you'd be happy to have just one. So remember that feeling when you go back into the real world.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks to the audience for your questions, for joining us this afternoon. Thank you so much, Patrick, Courtney, for this inspirational interview. You've given us a very useful set of tools to thrive and continue moving forward. On behalf of Anáhuac Mayab International, thank you all for tuning in this afternoon. Join us next week on Tuesday at 5 p.m. Central Time for our webcast, Global Leadership, A Lifelong Journey, with Karina Brown from Colorado State University. Remember that we at Anáhuac Mayab International are available to help you and work with you on your internationalization project. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook, and feel free to contact us at international@anahuac.mx. To end this transmission, I will leave you with a short video. Thank you very much for joining us, and see you next week.
Pues como diseñadora, estamos buscando siempre nuevas inspiraciones y diferentes tendencias, y la verdad es que una oportunidad increíble es este intercambio, conocer otras culturas, aprender de diferentes personas, diferentes lugares. Y pues en mi caso, Europa fue la mejor opción porque hay tantos países juntos. La verdad es que ha sido la mejor experiencia de mi vida. Aprendí muchísimo, conocí en la parte académica. Siento que igual la forma en la que te enseñan es diferente a la de aquí. Entonces todo lo que puedes aprender, los contactos, la gente, el idioma, la comida, todo es toda una experiencia que te ayuda mucho como persona. Entonces les invito a que se animen, que se atrevan, que vayan y conozcan y que se den cuenta de que vale la pena. No se van a arrepentir, de verdad, yo no lo valgo.